And what do you get?
It's got to be. Well, normally we would go with two oxides because oxides are more stable than peroxide. And so that's normally what we'd go. But if these were two oxides, then the total net negative charge would be minus 4. And then we have to balance out with a total positive charge of plus 4. We have two hydrogens. And so that means each hydrogen must be plus 2. Well, if a hydrogen is plus 2, then, we have a hydrogen with one electron, and if it loses one electron, it goes to plus 1. And so we have to have negative 1 electron on it. So, is it possible to have a negative electron? No. And so this is impossible. This charge is impossible. And so the only option, it's got to be a peroxide with a total negative charge of minus 2, which gives a total positive charge of plus 2. And so that means each hydrogen here must be plus 1. And so that works. And so this would be hydrogen peroxide, not the other. And so we could use the periodic table to determine, you know, if something's likely to exist or unlikely to exist. All right, let's continue on here with, so we finished sulfur hexafluoride, and we said, what did we say about sulfur heptafluoride? Sulfur heptafluoride, would you predict it exists or not? It doesn't. What about sulfur tetrafluoride? Is it possible that sulfur tetrafluoride exists? Yes, that's possible. The reason is because plus 6 is a lot of electrons to lose, so sometimes what we have is partial. Losing electrons is called oxidation, so sometimes we have partial oxidation.
So that's fine, sulfur tetrafluoride. Just like sulfur dioxide has sulfur plus 4. No, not all the way to plus 6. Okay, let's move on to this. Number 16, write an equation that shows the formation of rubidium ions from neutral rubidium atom. Now, this one, there's no multiple charges. Rubidium only has one charge. And how do I know? Well, it's positioned on the periodic table. Rubidium is an alkali metal in the first column. So, and it has a formula or symbol Rb. It's a metal. And so to form the cation Rb plus, what has to happen? It has to lose what? An electron. Where does that electron go? Well, it's got to go somewhere. And so it probably goes to another atom, like a chlorine atom. If chlorine gains an electron, it forms chloride. And this way we could form a salt like rubidium chloride. And so this would be the equation for the formation of rubidium ion from the rubidium atom. And it's a group 1 element. So let's continue here. What are the names of O2 minus and I minus? So what is O2 minus called? Oxide. I minus? Iodide. So this is just off the periodic table. Going on to number 20 here. What are the formulas of tin 4 ion? So tin 4 ion, let's stop there. What's the symbol for tin? This one's a tricky one. It's stannium. So tin is Sn. Now, 4, Roman numeral 4 means it's got to be plus 4. Tin's variable charge. Do you know what the other charge of tin is? We have plus 4 or 4 plus and plus 2 or 2 plus. Now, some people are very particular how they write. You know, do they write the sign before the number or the number before the sign? So the convention is for the anions, we usually write the number and then the sign. For the cations, we usually write the sign and then the number. So normally I write this not as 4 plus, normally I write it as plus 4. It doesn't really matter.
But if I had an anion, I would normally write the number for followed by the sign. But everybody will know what you're talking about.
And so you see it here. Mm-hmm. Here they write the number and then the sign. Other times it's the other.
I'm not very particular when it comes to that, so I don't really care
how you write it. All right, so that's tin 4. What's manganese 3 ion?
It'd just be Mg or Mn? Mn? 3 plus. Okay, what are the names of Pb2 plus? Pb2 plus, is that variable charge or fixed charge? Are there other charges on lead?
Yeah.
Lead's a variable charge, so we need the Roman numeral here. This is going to be called plumbium or lead 2. And then Co is cobalt. Is cobalt variable charge or fixed charge? Cobalt's a variable charge. The cobalt being variable charge means we need the Roman numeral. So this is cobalt, Roman numeral 2. And so the two charges on lead, we have lead 2 and the other ion is lead 4. Cobalt has a 2 and the other one is a 3. So 2, 3. On to number 22. What are the formulas for lithium nitride? So lithium nitride's a compound. Is it an ionic compound or a molecular compound? Is it a compound of nonmetals or metal and nonmetal? It's a metal and nonmetal. If it's a metal and nonmetal, we call it an ionic compound. So it's an ionic compound. Lithium. So we need the lithium ion. Is lithium ion fixed charge or variable charge?
Fixed.
And what is the charge?
Plus.
Nitride. What's the formula for nitride?
N3 minus.
Good. Nitride. N3 minus. And so how many lithiums do I need? Balance out the charge. I need 3 lithiums to give me a total charge of plus 3 and 1 nitride minus 3. So the formula is Li3N, lithium nitride. Chromium is variable charge. It could be chromium 2 or chromium 3. So this happens to be chromium 2, which is Cr with a 2 plus. And then chloride is fixed charge also. What's the charge on chloride? Minus 1. And so the formula we can get based on balancing out the charge. How many chlorides do I need to balance out the charge here? 2. And so this is going to give me chromium, or CrCl2, chromium 2 chloride. That would be it. The next one is aluminum phosphide. Aluminum is fixed charge. What's the charge on aluminum? Al3 plus. And phosphide is fixed charge. What's the charge on that? Phosphide. Okay, there's no oxygen in this. We have 3 types of anions. We have the I's, we have the A's, and the I's. The A's and the I's have oxygen, typically. The I's don't, except for peroxide, you know, and hydroxide. They aren't your typical polyatomics. And so the I's are usually monatomic. So phosphide comes from phosphorus. What's the charge on phosphorus ion? P Look at its position in the periodic table.
How many electrons does phosphorus have? Or
this 15 electron.
16, 17, 18. It's like 18 electrons. You like an argon here. And so it will gain 1, 2, 3 electrons. In other words, -1, -2, -3.
So this is going to be -3 or 3-. And so, it's balanced. So we don't need to add any more. So it's ALP, aluminum phosphide, ALP.
Tin 4 bromide is next.
So tin is variable charge. Tin either comes in 2 or 4. And so tin is Sn stannium. So we have tin 2. Was it tin 4? No, tin 4. We have tin 4 and bromide. What's the charge on bromide? -1 or just minus? So to balance this out, we need how many bromides?
4.
Yeah. Let's go ahead and do that. 4 bromides. And so this is going to be SnBr4. Oh, we saw this one before. This, I think we saw it.
Or something similar to that. You know, tin's kind of borderline. Tin is a semi-metal, so sometimes we'll name it via the molecular convention, sometimes we'll name it via the ionic convention. As an ionic compound, we call this tin 4 bromide. As a molecular compound, we would call it tin tetra bromide. And the only reason both names are somewhat acceptable is because tin is borderline.
Metal, non-metal. It occurs in the semi-metal region.
Right here.
Kind of the semi-metal region here, this zigzag area.
And so sometimes you'll see those named either way, you know, either as an ionic or a molecular compound. Okay, that's tin 4 bromide. Let's go on to the names of ionic compounds. So,
24, what are the names of MnF3? MnF3. Now, we have 1 manganese and 3 fluorines. Now, manganese, is that fixed charge or variable charge? It's a variable charge. So I don't know what the charge is. But fluorine, we got 3 of those. And I do know what the charge on fluoride is. What is the charge on fluoride? -1. And so that makes the charge on manganese. Yeah, this has got to be manganese 3. There's also manganese 2,
which is pretty common. But this is manganese 3. Should we name it as a molecular? If we name this as molecular, we would call it manganese trifluoride. But I would not name this as a molecular. I would name this as ionic because manganese is clearly a metal. And so this is a metal with non-metal. It's got to be ionic. It's going to be called, not manganese trifluoride, it's going to be called, well, it's the name of the cation. What's the name of the cation?
The name of the cation is manganese Roman numeral 3.
So that's manganese 3. The name of the anion is fluoride.
And so this is manganese 3 fluoride.
We would not call this manganese trifluoride or manganese 3 trifluoride because we don't need the prefix. We don't need the prefix because the charges tell us the ratio. NIS.
nickel variable or fixed charge?
A nickel turns out to be variable charge. I know your book says it's fixed charge, but we consider it variable charge.
But sulfur is not variable charge, usually. It has an anion. What's the charge on sulfur? 2-. And that means nickel's got to be 2+. And so the name of the cation is nickel 2. The anion is sulfide, so this is called nickel 2 sulfide. All right, here we get a tricky situation with PbO2. What was the situation with O2? When we see O2, sometimes we don't know if it's 1, O2. Well, I know lead. Is this lead? Well, lead typically forms plus 2 or plus 4. So is that lead plus 2 or lead plus 4? Usually we can tell by the anion, but there's a little bit of ambiguity because this might be 1 O2 2-. What do we call an O2 2-? Peroxide. Or it could be 2 O2 minuses, 2 oxides. If it's a peroxide, then this is lead 2. If it's oxide, then this is lead 4. Both of those exist. And so the only reason I'm going to go oxide here is because peroxides by nature are stable or unstable? Unstable. So we're just going to try to avoid it. And so I'm going to assume that these are oxides because it works with oxide here. If these are oxide, then this must be lead 4 plus. So the name for this is lead, Roman numeral 4, oxide. CO2S3. So next is CO2S3. All right, so we have two cobalts. Cobalt fixed charge or variable charge? Variable, but sulfide is not. Sulfide is fixed charge at 2-. And that means cobalt must be plus 3. So cobalt's plus 3, then we call it cobalt 3, Roman numeral, sulfide. That's cobalt 3 sulfide. All right, now we go on to a new section, the section I haven't talked about yet, section 6-8, nomenclature of oxoacids. But I don't want to just talk about oxoacids, I want to talk about all acids. So we're going to look at nomenclature of acids. Naming acids. Now all acids have H plus as the cation, the positive ion. The only difference between the acids is the anion. Anions are different. So the name of an acid is based on the anion name. So acid names are based on the anion. We have three types of anions. What are the three types of anions? The three types of anions that we have are the anions that end in IDE, like sulfide, phosphide, nitride, even some of the other ones that you just memorized, hydroxide, peroxide. We have the anions that end in ATE, and we have the anions that end in ITE. When we see a T, that means oxygen is present. When we see a D, it's likely oxygen is not present. So if the anion ends in IDE, then the acid we use the hydro prefix and the ic acid suffix. And so let me give you an example here. So we have HCl. So all acids have H plus as the cation. And in this case, we have chloride as the anion. So that's chloride. And so what we do is we take the anion name and then add the hydro. So this would be hydro, and then chlor. But we don't use the ide ending. We change the ending. And so this would be hydrochloric acid. And so all anions that end in IDE would have the hydro, ic, acid name. The ones that end in ATE, all we do is we just change the ending to ic acid. And so H2SO4, this would be the hydrogen cation with the sulfate anion. And so here we have sulfate, H plus with sulfate. Here we have H plus and chloride. So sulfate means we do sulfic acid. We change the ending.
So we go from sulfate to sulfic.
Now, however, sulfic has been modified a little bit. And so it's not really called sulfic, it's called sulfuric acid.
Historically, it's been called sulfuric acid. And so just a slight modification to the name here.
If we have the ite, we go aus acid. And so if we're looking at HNO2, what's the anion here? NO2 minus, which is nitrite. Sulfate is SO4 2 minus, chloride Cl minus. Nitrite is NO2 minus. And so we take the name of the anion and then just change the ending. So rather than nitrite, this is going to be called nitrous acid. So HNO2 is nitrous acid. Now your book has more categories. I only have three. Your book has more categories because they subcategorize this, which I don't think is necessary to do these subcategories. So let me tell you what they do. So for example, if I had HClO4, what's the anion here? The anion is ClO4 minus. So what is that? ClO4 minus.
Hydrochloric acid.
Well, this is an anion. ClO4 minus is called what is chlorate?
Chlorate.
Chlorine.
Four oxygen.
Close. Chlorine with three oxygens. So if chlorate is chlorine with three oxygens, then chlorine with four oxygens would be called
perchlorate.
And so this is perchlorate. If this is perchlorate, then this acid is called what? What do we do with eights? Ic acid. So this is called perchloric acid. Is this an eight? ClO minus is what? Well, if chlorate is ClO3, then ClO2 would be called
ClO2 would be called chlorite, and then ClO would be called hypochlorite. And so the name of this anion is hypochlorite. Hypochlorite. In other words, it's an ite. This was an eight. And so if it's an ite, what do we do to its name? We'll just change the ending. This would be called hypochlorous acid. And so three categories covers it. Your book has five categories, but
because they subdivide the hypo and the per, but it's not necessary.
So let's answer some of these questions here.
For acids. 26. What element is present in all acids discussed in this chapter? Hydrogen. Hydrogen is always present. In acids, the cation is always hydrogen. The acids that we look at.
Okay, 28. Which of the five memorized ic acids? We don't memorize any ic acids. Because we memorize this. We memorize the connection here. And therefore, we don't have to memorize individual acids. Although it's not bad. Your book has a different way of learning the acid names, which I'm not following at all. So 28, I'm going to skip that.
Let's fill in the blanks. Here.
All right, HCl. What's the name of the anion? Chloride. If we have an IDE, then we use hydroic. And so this would be, already did this one, but this would be hydrochloric acid. All right, now we have to go backwards in this. Actually, it doesn't matter. We can go both ways here. And so let's see if we can go backwards here. We're going to go from nitric acid and figure out its formula. So if we have nitric acid, we have the ic acid. If we have ic acid, then that means we must have the 8. And so nitric acid must mean we have nitrate. What's the formula for nitrate? Nitrate is a 3 oxygen or 4 oxygen? 8. Is it a 3 oxygen or 4 oxygen? 8. It's a 3. And what's the charge? Minus 1. And the cation is always the same. The cation is going to be the hydrogen ion. And so we only need one, and so the formula is HNO3. Nitric acid is HNO3. Hydrochloric and nitric acid are two of the most common acids that we have in chemistry. Two very common acids, HCl and HNO3. H3PO4 is also pretty common, H3PO4. Let's figure out the name for that. H3PO4. Okay, what's the anion here? The anion is PO4 charge? 3 minus. PO4 3 minus, what's that called? Phosphate. The anion is phosphate. And so we have an 8. If we have an 8, then it's ic acid. And so this should be phosphic acid. But historically, it's not been called phosphic acid. It's been called, the name's been modified a little bit, and it's called phosphoric acid rather than phosphic acid.
So just a slight modification, just like for sulfuric acid, exact same thing. All right, let's go on to the next one here, hydrosulfuric acid. Okay, now we have the hydro and the ick.
So hydrosulfuric acid. So if it's hydro, ick,
hydro ick must be I'd.
And so it's sulfuric, so it must be sulfuride. But sulfuride is funny. The name was modified. It's actually sulfide.
And so it's a hydro ick, we got to go with the I'd here. Sulfide means, well, what is sulfide?
S2 minus.
So how many hydrogen ions do we need for this?
Two. And so we're going to get H2S. H2S is called hydrosulfuric acid, aka hydrogen sulfide. It's more commonly known by this name, hydrogen sulfide. Hydrogen sulfide is a rotten egg smell.
It's hydrosulfuric acid. Okay, let's go on to HNO2.
So HNO2, the anion is going to be NO2 minus.
What's NO2 minus? That must be nitrate, is that right? Nitrate, no. Nitrate has three or four oxygens. Three. Nitrate has three oxygens, so this must be nitrite.
So if this is nitrite, then the name of the acid, well, it's ite, so we just go aus acid. And so the name of this acid is nitrous acid.
Okay, this one says hydroselenic acid. Hydroselenic acid, it's the hydro ick. That means we have the ide. And so hydroselenic acid means we must have selenide.
So what is selenide, the formula for selenide? Selenide is Se, 2 minus. And so we'll need two hydrogen ions to balance out the charge. It's going to be H2SE. This would be hydroselenic acid.
Okay, let's look at HClO4 there.
If I look at HClO4, then I'm looking at the ClO4 minus.
Is ClO4 minus chlorate? No, chlorate is three oxygens, right? And so ClO4 would be?
ClO4 would be per or hypo? Per. Hypo means less. Per chlorate.
It's one more oxygen than chlorate. Chlorate ClO3 minus. So per chlorate would be ClO4 minus. It's an 8. So what do? We change it to ic acid. We already did this one. We'll do it again.
Perchloric acid.
Perchloric acid is a very powerful acid.
Then let's go on here. Next one is hydroiodic acid. So we have hydro again, hydroic. Hydroic must mean we change the ending. So hydro, drop the hydro, the ick, we are left with iodine.
So we're going to change the ending to iodide.
Iodide. Iodide has what charge? Minus one. And so hydroiodic acid, we need one H plus. We're going to get HI. That's hydroiodic acid.
Here. HI.
Okay, HClO2 comes next. HClO2 has the ClO2 minus.
So what was chlorate again? 3 oxygens or 4 oxygens? Chlorate was 3 oxygens. So 2 oxygens would be called chlorite.
So this is chlorite.
And so it's an ite.
And so we use house acid. And so the acid name here would be chlorous acid. Just change the ending. Chlorite, house, chlorous. Okay, then we go to selenic acid. Selenic acid, so we have ic acid here. It's not hydroselenic acid, which we just did. This is selenic acid. So ic acid means it's got to be selenate. What is selenate? Ion. Selenium is below sulfur, so what is selenic ion? Se. And what, so it's a little sulfur, so what is sulfate? Sulfate was 4 oxygen or 3 oxygen? Sulfate's a 4 oxygen, so selenate must be 4 oxygen. You know, when we have a T here, it indicates we got some oxygen. What's the charge? It'd be the same as sulfate, 2 minus. And so this would be selenate. For selenic acid. And we'll need 2 hydrogens to balance out the charge. So it's going to be H2SeO4. It'll be selenic acid, H2SeO4. And then we have this one here, which is HBrO2. HBrO2 has the BrO2 minus ion. BrO2, what's bromate? Is it 3 oxygen or 4 oxygen?
3.
And so this has 2 oxygen, so that must mean this is bromide. Well, it's an ite, so we just change the ending. And so this will be bromous acid. Those are the acids there, but we also have something called acid anions. Oh, no, sorry. I jumped ahead. We're in section 6.9, nomenclature of oxoanions. And so, number 32, what is the formula of arsenate? So what is arsenate? I'm trying to use the periodic table to figure out what arsenate is. Well, what's the symbol for arsenic? AS. And so arsenate, 3 oxygens or 4 oxygens?
Arsenate. 3 oxygens.
If you notice the pattern is this L is 3 oxygens. And then everything inside that L is 4 oxygens. Remember, aluminate, how many oxygens? 4. Silicate, how many oxygens?
4.
Phosphate, how many oxygens?
4.
Everything inside here is 4 oxygens. So arsenate should have 4 oxygens. So arsenate, we expect to be AsO4. Now we've got to figure out the charge.
What is the charge on this?
So silicate was minus 4, phosphate is minus 3, sulfate is minus 2. Now, what happens in this pattern, you've got to spend time with this pattern, because if I just tell you, you don't necessarily memorize it, you got to see it for yourself. These are going to have the same charge, so arsenate is going to be like phosphate. Arsenate and phosphate are both going to have 3 minus. Selenate and sulfate are both going to have 2 minus. And so arsenate is AsO4 3 minus.
It's in the pattern.
What are the names of TE?
Okay, oops.
Can't see it. Let's see the word.
Are we out of time?
Yeah. All right, we'll continue this next time.